Welcome back, and thank y'all for tuning in to another edition of the War Room Podcast. We are here to discuss the AFC North, the stacked AFC North. We got, what, two divisions to go, right? AFC North, AFC West, best divisions in football, bar none, no questions asked. Before we get into that and some current events, some breaking news, some good stuff. Gentlemen, how are we doing today? You guys feeling good that we're almost finally here?
Yeah. I've been waiting to talk about this division for a while.
Good day.
And the guy next to me is why.
Doing well. Just realized Chaz was all decked out. I didn't notice that before.
Oh, you didn't? You didn't see the
Should have known.
Sucks that's not a Super Bowl.
I know.
Yeah.
But
yeah. Just saying. I never bought that gear, but I guess I still could, right?
Yeah.
Not that too far removed. But good, man. It feels good. We got football this week. Football on Thursday. It doesn't even feel right to be like, yeah, football's on Thursday. Like the Hall of Fame game. Mm-hmm. Like I don't know. Just the structure of the preseason is still kind of messing with me. I wasn't completely against it. I wasn't completely for it, them shortening it. I understand it because of the injuries. I didn't like it because you might as well just play like the rest of those guys in those 3 or 4 week span. But I get it. It is what it is. But we got football this week, so I'm stoked. I know you guys are. But we do have a few things to talk about in terms of newer news, breaking news, stuff that's coming to come across the ticker over the last few days. Deebo Samuel's got paid. I think it's roughly, 3 years, 75 mil-ish. I think two of the three is guaranteed, right? Another short contract for a wide receiver so that they can hit the market again young. There's also, it's incentively, riddled. So, basically, he can get paid and compensated for running the ball. I still think they maybe after this offseason they dial it back down, but maybe they don't. Maybe that was enough for him to be like, yeah, I'll run the ball if you pay me this, and then they matched it. So who knows? But, I mean, what's your guys' take on this transaction that happened? Especially because we thought that Jimmy G was going to be the tipping point once they cut him. But apparently they had enough money to do this once they cut D4.
Yeah, first off, I'm sorry. You want to go first, Chaz?
Oh, you can go for it. You can go for it.
Cool. Thank you. First off, congrats to Deebo if you're listening to this, which we'll see. Maybe one day you will. But congrats on the new contract. Well deserved. I wasn't shocked that they came to this deal quicker. I thought it was going to be until Jimmy G got traded. But then when D Ford got released, I sort of thought to myself, yeah, this might be the time to finally get Deebo locked up. He's too valuable for this team to lose. But now they got him locked up for 3 years. They avoided a big problem with this contract for upcoming weeks. And yeah, I like it. Definitely, it was a must to bring him back.
Yeah, for sure. They always wanted to get this done. This was always like in the plans for the 49ers. Like they, like the trade request, the scenic route. They took that to get here, but they always wanted to extend Deebo. That was always in their plans. And really, it's just the product of this wide receiver market. It was fun to like, this has been one of the most entertaining off seasons in terms of that. And it's funny because of that entire class, we're going to talk about the last one that hasn't gotten signed today in Deontay Johnson. And I don't think Pittsburgh is going to indulge in that, to be honest. And
not at that price tag.
And I don't, it's a weird spot to talk about. I mean, we'll get there when we get there about Deontay, but I'm a fan. I like Deontay Johnson. Do I think he's worth the amount of money that AJ Brown and Terry McLaurin and Deebo just got? No, not at all. And even AJ Brown even tweeted out, did you see where it said, all these wide receivers basically signed the same contract. I'm the only one that got traded.
Yeah.
So Deontay might be the same on that same boat. He might end up getting moved maybe by the deadline, if it's depending on how they start
Yeah, I can see them. I could definitely see them get them moving on from Deontay Johnson, especially because I think, like, he's somewhere in the middle between that Hunter Renfrow contract and the Deebo contract. I think he's, in terms of at least, like, you got to pay him a little more than you pay Hunter Renfrow because he's supposed to be the number one on the team right now. Hunter was clearly the number two and also kind of limited in terms of, like, he's a slot route runner. You know, like, you can only pay those guys so much. Even if you can say that they deserve more or whatnot, you know, they've never, the slot receiver is never typically the guy that's getting paid number one. It's usually the X. And so I could see that, but I think it's money well deserved.
Well, I mean, going in the Deontay thing, like, you can say you may not like him as much as these other guys. He's not as good as these other guys, whatever. If you put up the production he has, he's right up there in the mix with McLaurin and with Brown, with all those guys. He's right up in there production-wise. So they're going to ask for that same contract. Right. Pittsburgh may not give it to him. They might not be the team that gives it to him, but that's the contract that they're going to go for.
Agreed, but you also got to look at this man was targeted heavily by Pittsburgh, like a lot. Mm-hmm. And you can also argue that that's, you know, how important he is to that offense, but Big Ben definitely peppered him with targets a lot throughout the last couple seasons. So it's just they did draft two receivers, so he, like, it's other people who can take up that target share, but we have to see, especially if, you know, they distribute and give Freiermuth more targets, you know, and then you got Austin and Pickens, who's in flashing in camp a lot. So we'll see what happens. I'm not gonna, you know, say he's he's written off. He's guaranteed to get traded anyway. He could stay up on rosters this whole season, but if they're not going to sign him at that contract, at that price tag where he's going to be asking for because he has that production, then they're going to try to get something back for him.
For sure. For sure. I don't think anyone else, I think everyone, any other wide receivers are going to be in that mix or less until Justin Jefferson, probably. Justin Jefferson's going to top that. That'll be the next bump up, Jamar Chase after that. But other than those guys, no one else is really going to be getting that kind of money. Everyone else is going to be getting less than that until a couple more years down the road when these rookies and
I wouldn't stuff rule out start. T. Higgins in that
That's
either.
Exactly. That's what I was going to say. That's the only other arguable one is T. Higgins, because T. Higgins was the 33rd pick, so he doesn't have that fifth-year option buffer that Justin Jefferson. But they'll get Justin Jefferson done during that window, too. I don't think they'll wait for that.
But I don't know, since he's not going to pay Higgins and Chase.
Cincinnati has always paid their second receivers. Always.
They still got – they got Burrow coming up, and they can't pay Bates. And, they're going to have to make some decisions there, Chaz.
I agree with you.
We'll get into it later.
All right. Previously on the podcast.
Yeah. Don, would you like to get your 2 cents in on the Deebo contract, even though we really haven't talked about Deebo at all in this contract or in this segment?
I mean, I think – it was warranted, and like you guys said, it needed to get done. Both sides wanted it. And he's been one of the largest, if not the largest, tool in that arsenal for that offense. So keeping him in the house out in San Francisco was essential to their plans moving forward.
All right, so I have it right here in terms of, I think maybe the best way to break this down might be yards per target in terms of, like, how freaking insane Deontay Johnson. I have Deontay Johnson, Deebo Samuels, and A.J. Brown. Last year, you got to take the running game out of it because that's not Deontay Johnson or A.J.'s Brown game, so you can't really factor that into the equation. But in terms of targets, 169 targets to 107 catches, and 144 targets to 88. And Debo's max is 121. AJ Brown's max is 106 last year, and he had eclipsed 1,000 yards twice already. Debo's eclipsed 1,400 yards receiving, and then plus the 365 on the ground. So they might be kind of sort of comparable, but really not really when you factor in the amount of targets and then you look at yards per target, and there is a big, big drop off with Deontay Johnson compared to A.J. Brown or Deebo Samuel. So yeah, maybe stat-wise, but they're definitely not the same player. That being said, like, Christian Kirk getting paid that amount of money, I think Deontay Johnson definitely earned himself a slight pay grade above Christian Kirk. But then again, that's a pay grade above freaking, you know, Chris Godwin. And I don't think anybody's going out there to say that Deontay Johnson is Chris Godwin. Personally, maybe you guys are, I don't know. And other news, the Miami Dolphins, which I will relate on over to Dominic in terms of the actual disciplinary actions. You could probably be a little bit better than that on me, but a first and a third, I think like over $1.5 million total in fines and a year suspension for the owner. I think a half year suspension for the co-owner, who was
the other way around.
Okay. Well, these assholes thought that they were going to snake Tom freaking Brady for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. The nerve of you assholes to try and pull a fast one and go get Sean Payton and Tom Brady under the table. I'm so glad this happened to you guys. How dare you? Rebuttal. Go for it. That's all I had to say. You got nothing?
Nothing?
I mean, I...
Bury your team. Be like, I'm ashamed of my team. I can't believe they would do this. But in hindsight, I know you're like, damn, if only it would have worked.
Honestly, they didn't learn from their own history, you know? They had this whole flirtation with Harbaugh when they had Tony Sperano coaching the team.
Yeah.
You know? And now they got caught. You know? I mean, I'm so mad about this.
Because Brady was on board, too. That's the biggest thing. Now this is exactly why Brady retired, to see if this could happen. So now, like, I can't be too mad at Brady, you know? But, like, I'm never so excited about this shit.
What about his teammates? Teammates can say, man, you're about to bail on us, go to Miami?
I can't.
Well, yeah. I'm back now. I'm back.
Yeah. But then you get it, you're like.
I know it's Tom. I know it's Tom. It's Tom. I know it's Tom.
Yeah, exactly. One on the bridge. As long as you're on our team right now, I don't give a shit. That's kind of how I feel. But after he retires, I'm going to have a word. I'm going to have a word with that man.
What I don't get, I mean, not that I don't get it, but just the, like, audacity of the owner to come out with a statement to be like, see, oh, I'm vindicated from Brian Flores, all his stuff.
He did not come across well with that.
And this punishment isn't right. I don't know what this is all about, but oh, at least all of the stuff that Brian Flores said, like, come on, man, are you serious?
Oh yeah, I clearly wasn't tanking.
Yeah, come on now. his first game back eligible is Dolphins against Steelers. If I'm reading that correctly, also with Flores coaching the Steelers.
Good, go Steelers.
What I got to say about this is, many are talking about how this is going to affect Ross more. I think this hurts Bruce Beal more than anything, because he was going to be given the team if when the time comes of Ross's.
He still is.
Let me continue with this. Here's what I'm saying. I wonder if this affects his ownership status, because Ross doesn't come across well. The Dolphins don't come across well. Beal, especially if he takes over, I don't know what's going to go on. You don't know what's going on in the future with him. If he takes over, he's not going to come across well as the owner, not only with the fan base, but the entire, you know, people who he's going to work with ownership wise, they're not going to treat him that well. I mean, yes, you could say all they really care about is money, but my point is, I think this affects more Beal than it does Ross. Ross, the suspension sucks, but the millions of dollars he's getting fined, but that's like cheese to him. Like, he can pay that off anytime he wanted to.
Drop in the bucket. Dom, my question to you, are you mad that they tried, or are you mad that they got caught?
I guess I'm more mad that they tried.
Shocked.
Because I liked Flores. I still do. And I've always been a fan of building a team. Not just accumulating talent. Yes, it's Brady. Yes, it's Peyton. You've got the greatest quarterback to ever basically play the game, and you've got one of the greatest minds of football to coach the team, possibly. At least that was their intent, you know. But I've always been a fan of building a team.
You can build a team through multiple ways. You are allowed to build a team through free agency. You're allowed to build a team through trades. I love the draft. I love it so much. This is my thing. You can build a team through free agency. That's not an illegitimate way to build a team.
I'm not saying it's not a illegit. It's a perfectly fine way to build a team. I'm not saying that. But it's a discussion of accumulating talent or accumulating a team.
I think what he's trying to say is it's kind of a slap in the face for the process to get to this point to build that team. But in this chair right here, knowing that all it took was Tom Brady for us to win a championship, like once he got on the team, we won a championship. And that literally was the entire catalyst, because no matter how good our roster was at that point, if you would have put Jameis in that seat, in that driver's seat, we wouldn't have won nothing. Like, Tom Brady would have won. Possibly Tom Brady would have won Miami Dolphins. Like, with that team and that stacked roster, that wide receiving core, that defense, the plethora of running backs and the run game. Like, the only thing you can question, which we did just the other week or a couple weeks ago, was the offensive line. Like, and I'm sure Tom would have had his way in, like, forcing every veteran free agent offensive lineman to come to Miami, of all places. But I get what Brady was doing. Brady wanted to be a player owner that won a championship, like set another record, set another precedent of something that no one else will ever accomplish. I get that. It's a little greedy in my sense, especially when you look at the team that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers have. Very, very greedy. But I kind of can't be mad at him. Like, he's just trying to break records. But
I'll say one other thing about Miami. Think about how this team was. They were on the right track. Their future was looking bright. They were getting there, and it's all fallen apart for Miami. Not only – who knows what Mike McDaniel will be. I still think he'll be a fine addition. I'm not a fan of him over Flores, but this team had draft picks. They had hope, but it's seemingly being, like, deteriorating now. It's like the slow drive with them, and now with this whole thing, they lost a draft pick, which – who knows if it'll be the 49ers pick or the Dolphins pick? I don't know. I think it's going
to be the Dolphins. It has to be the Dolphins.
It has to be the Dolphins. Okay, then it'll have to be the Dolphins pick.
But I will add this, though, to counter Nick's point, and sorry for interrupting, Nate. I was at camp the 30th, and the energy there is palpable. So the fans are all on board with this team.
Yeah.
You know?
Are
pulling for the, like, the players are loose and having fun out there in addition in the new offense. So it's a good feeling.
My whole thing with this, honestly, is if you imagine being Tua, bro. Like, Tua.
Oh, I feel so bad with Tua.
Under Flores tried to replace Tua with Deshaun Watson. Like, that's public knowledge now. And that didn't happen. And it's like, okay, my head coach didn't like me. He's gone. I got new ones, whatever. Now you hear that your owner was trying to replace you with Tom Brady. Now I get it. It's Tom Brady. But, like, is everybody in this organization trying to replace me, bro? Like
it's basically Josh Rosen with talent.
Tua has got a long leash, though. Like, if you look at the rest of the guys, like, you know, over the last few years and Josh Rosen and all these other guys, like, the leash is short. It's a 2-year window. We talked about this, you know, and throughout this series.
All right.
You got 2 years. You can say 3, and, like, you can be the Giants and give Daniel Jones 3 or 4 years to figure it out, 5 years to figure it out, but, like, you're just doing it to yourself, you know? You're just pissing off your franchise and your fan base. At least with Miami bringing in Tyreek Hill kind of gives an attitude. It gives, like, a, like, going all-in attitude on this year, going all-in on Tua. Like, again, I don't fault Tua really at all for the last 2 years. Rookie year, we knew what that was.
Exactly. Because he was coming off the injury.
Yeah.
So we can say we all have the two-year window for you, you know, hit that stride and be like, okay, we're going to build around this guy. drafting him off of his injury in top five, you had to know it was going to take longer to know if he was going to be your guy or not. Mm-hmm. So the fact that you drafted him with that intent and then you tried to replace him within 2 years before he's even had a chance to, like, catch his stride, he was already trying to get replaced, or they were already trying to replace him with Watson. Now they're trying to replace him with Brady, and he was going to take more time in the first place. It just doesn't help that you got drafted in between Joe Burrow and Justin Herbert, and you were drafted ahead of Justin Herbert.
So if Tua doesn't succeed, he's got all these weapons. He's got no excuses. He doesn't succeed. Now they have less ammo to move up to get a quarterback. Mm-hmm. So now they're even more of a spot to be like, oh well, crap. Now that play's gone.
Yeah, it's literally that was their whole MO, was like, all right, we'll trade back, and if Tua don't work out, we got the ammo for next year. So literally
now that's gone.
Yeah, they just butchered them. Their whole plan just got shot to shit for them being too greedy. But what are you going to do?
Gentlemen. Yeah, the one other thing I just wanted to say on Nick's deal was, if they ain't talking about removing Dan Snyder, they're not going to remove Stephen Ross.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I guess so, but I don't rule anything out with this league.
Dan Snyder was messing with the other owner's money. Stephen Ross
exactly.
wasn't.
Exactly.
So if Dan Snyder
was like, Stephen Ross was messing with the integrity of the game, though.
He exactly. So he and
Dan Snyder wasn't now, Dan Snyder wasn't tainting the shield.
And
he was tainting the shield, but he wasn't killing the integrity of the game, like tanking.
Yeah.
Like, and even though they say he was joking.
If Stephen Ross does sell this
team, it's a fine line.
If Stephen Ross does sell this team, it's not going to be the Beal.
No, I think it is. I think it hands down is. It's still going. Everything that didn't happen this year will happen. Tom Brady will own that team. Sean Payton's going to get his cut. Regardless, like, I think all of that is still in play. They're just going to take their slap on the wrist. Everybody but Brady and Sean Payton are going to take that slap on the wrist. But which I will say, the NFL, it's one of the few rules I think I appreciate, the fact that legal tampering can't get the player in trouble. So, thank God. I will say that.
And I also think that, if I'm not mistaken, Sean Payton and Tom Brady both have the same agent. And I think that agent is that, like, the reason they didn't get in trouble. Obviously, the player can't get in trouble for tampering, but, like, they got off scot-free. I bet that agent was like, hey, it's all what all went down. I bet he was the snitch. They had him in a room with the McDonald's.
How did he? Yeah, that's true. He might have. That now I think about it, that's true, because I was wondering, how is this agent not getting suspended for this? Because
he's an agent. This really can't do shit to an agent.
I know. I'm just saying, how is the agent not fully in trouble? You know, but that's the side point. But yeah, it's a dark light for the Dolphins. It's a dark light for Ross. They'll figure a way to get over. It's a shame too. It's just a shame.
Let's not forget that this all kicked off because Bill Belichick accidentally texted the wrong Brian. Playing chess, not checkers.
Dude, 3D chess. Oh my god. Do you really think that this was Bill all along? This was Bill pulling strings?
He's known for his dark arts and coaching. You know?
He's been Palpatine all along. But you know what's crazy?
He really is Voldemort.
Nick, Dom, we were in Mobile when this story first kicked off.
Mm-hmm.
That happened during the Senior Bowl week.
Yep.
Because I remember getting back to the Airbnb and being absolutely flabbergasted by reading this report. I was on Twitter for like 2 hours straight.
All right, we're already almost like 20 to a half an hour in, and we haven't even started on the AFC North. So no better time like the present. If some Tevin Smith news comes up, we'll talk about that.
Jenkins.
Jenkins. Sorry, Tevin
Smith.
Jenkins. I was like, I don't know.
Tevin Smith is retired.
Yeah, I know. That's why I was like, I'm butchering this right now. Migraines for 3 days, gentlemen. Anyways, the AFC North, the Baltimore Ravens, somehow ended up in last place last year of this division after a hot start, after losing basically everybody on their team. One tackle, another offensive lineman, wide receiver. Like, it was one after another, after another, after another. And they were the 1A to the Buccaneers in terms of injury-riddled teams. And so you have to kind of take all of that into perspective. This team's coming back. This team had another outstanding draft class. But they also lost their number one wide receiver. Number one wide receiver who just got in trouble and I think arrested last night. Yep. So that, you know, in hindsight, maybe that all works out for the Ravens. But they are definitely lacking talent in terms of pass catchers, in terms of wide receiving cores. The defense is stacked. It always is. But I think this always goes back to the imprint that Ozzie Newsome has left on this team in terms of the way they draft and the style they draft and the fact that they just hit at such an accelerated rate. And there's so many of my favorite guys on this draft class. Obviously, there's a few. There's Nicholas has got, you know, two of his
Linderbaum,
favorite
guys. Linderbaum,
baby. And Flolele on that draft class.
Who will start games next year, by the way?
Let's see about Please. That one. I mean, they brought in an offensive tackle this year, and they have, you know, Stanley.
Morgan Moses, who was fantastic for the Jets, and I wish the Jets brought him back. But
so you think Flolele is going to
I would love to see him play. Okay. I think he's going to be a star in this league.
All right. Remember, there's another one. I love that player.
okay, how about this? How about this, man? When you scout this guy and you're super high on him, I deserve a pass on this one. And Linderbaum. And Woolen.
All right. We shall see. But, again, I think a healthy Lamar Jackson, an offensive line, a run game, and that defense, I don't know if they can win playoff football, but this team damn sure can win regular season football and can do it handily. This is the team I think that's got the most blowout wins, like basically since Lamar Jackson entered the league, right? In terms of like straight blowouts, like, you know, 21-0 before the end of the first quarter type stuff. It's things you see in Madden. So this team's going to be a contender. They're going to have their way. They're going to make the playoffs. I firmly believe they will. Dominic, I'll kind of start off with you. Like, where do you think this team has gone right or wrong so far in this offseason, and kind of where do you see them going?
I mean, kind of like you, I love the defense. They've always been a run team, and the pass game has always been that sort of secondary option to that running game. That being said, that's the one area where there's no, like, scary factor in that receiving core that teams are going to have to at least be aware of. And I would question the depth in their tight end room. I mean, that's a lot of tight ends, especially adding two this past draft. So,
two of my favorites, too.
quite good tight ends, you know, but when you already have Mark Andrews and I kind of question where they're gearing themselves towards.
Jumbo sets, baby. Three tight ends.
A whole lot of
tight ends. They're going five wide, all tight ends.
They're going back to the Pitta days where they had like Pitta, Crockett, Gilmore, and what's his face was the backup. Was it Clark? I forgot I was the other guy. But yeah, I like
how
the Baltimore.
How dare you reference Ravens tight ends and not mention Todd Heap?
About Todd Heap. I'm sorry. Yeah, you can.
With the Dennis Pitta.
That guy, before the hip injuries got him, Pitta was a player.
I think Ed Dixon was the other guy you were thinking of.
Ed Dixon. Yes, it was Ed Dixon. Thank you. Thank you, Nate. You're saying. but I like what Baltimore did. I could talk all day about, you know, how improved this offensive line got with Linderbaum and Lele, but there's plenty of film out there somewhere in the on the channel, you know, of me hyping these two guys. But the one issue I really have on offense is injuries, because that's what killed them last year. And I don't remember if it was I think it was Gus Edwards who's having like a setback with his recovery. The running core, you know, we'll see with who starts there, because Dobbins, I think, is still on the PUP. And Justice Hill, I've heard, is the guy for now in training camp news. But receiver-wise, I said earlier, they're going back to the Dennis Pitta years where they're going to utilize the tight ends. But the one question I have with offense is the injuries. And if Lamar will play like Lamar did last year, because, look, I don't hate Lamar Jackson. I think he's a solid quarterback, definitely either top 10 or 15 QB in the league. But his mobility was key. Like, he's not bad at passing the ball, but his mobility was very key. And I hope he's healthy enough and he can run the way he did and be as mobile as he can. But he's a big question mark. You can't deny it. And I do think he's going to get paid once you know, all the negotiations get taken care of eventually. But this is his prove it year because of that injury. Defense, they bolstered a lot. I cannot wait to see when. I don't think he's going to play this year. I don't know how Achilles injuries run nowadays. You know, with the Cam Akers stuff. If Ojabo, I think I'm saying his name wrong. Odafe, Jason Owe are healthy. That's a pass rushing duo to fear, and it terrifies me or anyone. But yeah, I like what they did bringing Kyle Hamilton. We'll see where they put him at. But yeah, this team is definitely scary. I don't think they're going to win the division. I think this division's Cincinnati, but they're close. I think Baltimore is definitely going to give Cincinnati a run for their money for that division spot.
My turn?
Yeah.
I'm going in?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, I do think it's a two-team race, quote-unquote, and we'll get into the other two next here, but the only reason Baltimore is down in this spot is because they got tore up last year with injuries. I mean, that's same thing we can say about everybody, but they have a fatal flaw, and that fatal flaw is they don't have somebody that can threaten the defense in the passing game, just as a pass catcher. I do think Mark Andrews is a top three tight end in the league, receiving wise. Isaiah Likely is probably my favorite receiving tight end prospect that came out in the draft last year. I know Tyler Mooney on staff, he was very high on Charlie Kolar. He was in his top five tight ends. So you got, like, you have pass catchers at the tight end spot. But let's not forget about Rashad Bateman. I love me some Rashad Bateman. He was one of my favorite receiver prospects coming out of last year. I think he could be a number one wide receiver, but do I think he has that we're gonna clear the box out and not play eight men in the box every play against these? He has to prove that. So early on, it's going to be a lot of opportunity for him to produce because he's going to have to win on the outside. So pro tip to all those fantasy players watching this, Rashad Bateman should have a big first few weeks in the league or in this season this year because defenses are going to have to adjust to him. And he's going to have the opportunities to make plays. And I just don't think when it comes down to, like, shooting in the AFC against Herbert and Mahomes and Allen and Burrow and all these guys, like, I love Lamar. I think Lamar is right there in that conversation. I think he's, like, his name belongs to be in those five. Those other guys have Ja'Marr Chase, Keenan Allen, Mike Williams. The only team that doesn't is the Chiefs, but Patrick Mahomes is a different type of passer than Lamar Jackson is. So Bills got Steph Diggs. They don't have that guy that can take that pressure off of Lamar. And if he has to run all the time, and he didn't get hurt running the ball. I don't want people to think that that's a thing, that he got injured because he runs a lot. It's not why he got hurt. He got hurt dropping back. I think a Browns player, like, hit his foot or something while he was, like, after he threw the ball.
Yeah.
So, like, he didn't get hurt running
the, he was in the pocket, right?
Yeah, I think he had just released the ball, and like a Browns player, like, it wasn't even roughing the passer. It was just like incidental contact. Yeah.
And that was after Ronnie Stanley had already been put on IR.
Right. And Ronnie Stanley's one of the best young tackles in the league, and he was gone. Their entire secondary was decimated. Like, they'll be back. I'm not worried about them. They'll be firmly in the playoff picture. Mm-hmm. Like we all said, I think very strongly that Cincinnati-Baltimore Week 18 can be for the division. I don't think necessarily that one team or the other is going to take it over the other, because it's a lot. It's 16 games to play before then. But on paper, that game should be for the division.
Yeah, I agree. I'm with you all the way on that with Baltimore. You know, provided they stay healthy, they're going to be right in the mix for the division and also for the wild card. It's going to be a tough conference, but they're going to be in the mix with all those other teams. I think they'll bounce back. Like I said, as long as they didn't have the fluke injuries they had, because there was, I don't know, everyone out, it seemed like. I like Dobbins in the run game as their lead back there. He's saying he's adamant he's ready by week one. They drafted another one, Batty from Missouri. Beatty. Yeah, Batty. A lot of people really liked him coming out as well. But yeah, I'm with you all the way. I think they're gonna change their offense again, more towards Lamar. They're gonna go to those, you know, 13 personnel and run them tight ends out there. Maybe have one of them tight ends as kind of a, you know, power slot, as we call it, type of deal.
Coin here, TM. Come on, everybody using it. We're coming for that ass.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see what they do. I'm a big fan of Bateman as well, but they don't really have anyone else besides him. Their defense, I think, is going to be legit. I really like their draft class as a whole. Was really solid, pretty impressive. The interesting thing, I think, is going to be, like, if they're doing all this work to, you know, get the tight ends and go to that kind of style of offense, if they're changing all that around, is going to be the contract stuff with Lamar. Like, they're almost setting themselves up to where they are going to pay him, but he's going to ask for that $230 fully guaranteed. Like, why wouldn't you? That's the starting point. You know, you got the other, you know, the Kyler contract coming in with not as much guarantees. So it'll be interesting to see which way they go with that and what they're willing to pay out for that. But
the number is 178 total games missed due to IR last season. Oof. On the Baltimore Ravens team. 168 games.
That's 49ers level of insanity in 2018, I think it was, that they
one of those years. Yeah, they got
that was the pandemic year. I'm sorry.
I think this is the worst IR I've ever seen. Like, if you look at the chart, it's crazy. It's just solid red. Like, half of their, like, starting chart. Like, I'll send this to you guys when we're done. It's crazy. But I don't know. Again, one of the best draft classes. The fact that we haven't mentioned the name Kyle Hamilton, to me, is crazy. They got the best player in the entire draft, number one on, like, every board. We had Chaz's favorite player in the draft. Everyone was hounding about this guy. So the fact that, like, the rich got richer because they had an injury-riddled season is going to be – that's a good point you brought up. Because you remember when the Niners had that injury-riddled year, but yet they still had all those starters coming back after that year, and they got to draft Bosa because of it. So then, boom, they get to draft Kyle Hamilton because of it. Now they have Kyle Hamilton and Marcus Williams. So even if they can't take the top off of off of somebody else's defense, very little teams are going to be able to take the top off of them. So, like, they're literally built to win. They are built to do what they do best. And, I mean, Lamar Jackson's passing attack has never been something to really fear to begin with, no matter who they have there, even with Hollywood Brown, who I think is a, you know, B wide receiver at best. He's a solid number, a good number two. So, like, they have, you know, Bateman was somebody that, you know, we were high on. I was definitely a little bit of, you know, homer bias in Devin Duvernay, but I love Duvernay, and I was a massive fan of Prochet once, you know, Roy Countryman had shown him to the rest of the scouting department in terms of what he brought to the table. So there's plenty of talent to go around. And again, I will question this team. I would struggle to think that this team can get past a real playoff contender once playoff time comes and you can make them 100% one-dimensional in playoff football. But until then, weeks 1 through 17, 1 through 18, good luck beating this team. Because I think now if, you know, Baltimore goes and plays KC, which I don't know if they have them on the record this year, like that game's a lot closer. You know, that game, and it was a back and forth and a super close battle before in the last couple of years that they played each other. I think now I almost give the advantage to them, even though that, you know, both teams have lost their number one wide receiver this year. Moving on.
Oh. They don't play this year, though. I was just saying.
No, I was saying, yeah. If I was like saying if they end up playing each other this year. I know I didn't think they were on the regular season schedule. Moving on to the cluster you-know-what that is the Cleveland Browns. And now we can kind of get into this whole spiel that is the Deshaun Watson situation that we've said we're going to stay out of, that we're going to keep it football. Now we're talking about the division. We kind of have to talk about this. We don't have to talk about the details. We don't have to go into, you know, what side are you on or how many games you think he should be suspended or any of that. We just have to talk what we think and what we know. Right now we know that 6 games is not enough. Chaz, this is your division. You are close kind of to this situation, more so than the rest of us. So kind of what do you think's going on with the Deshaun Watson situation, with the Cleveland Browns? Roger Goodell appealed. So it's now in Goodell's hands, but then it's then going to go to the court's hands then again, right?
So the way the new CBA worked, they obviously went to the judge. Sue, I'm forgetting their last name. I think it's Robinson, Judge Sue Robinson, about the appeals process. So they both presented their cases. Deshaun Watson presented his case of why he shouldn't be suspended. The NFL presented their cases of why he should. So the important thing to note here is that she can only make a ruling based off of what the NFL presented. The NFL only presented 5 cases out of the 24 accusations. And famous lawsuits that are all going on at 23 are settled at this point. But she only made her decision of 6 games based off of those 5 cases that the NFL presented. So, which is in line because she said she used precedent based off of previous NFL punishments for this type of actions. So, and that checks out because Big Ben got 6 games. And Ezekiel Elliott got 6 games, but they also had 1 accuser each at the time. And Deshaun Watson has 5 of which she was judging on. So also important thing to note is that she pointed out that they did in their investigation find that his actions were negative. Like he did something at the bare minimum. So anybody to say because he get convicted in a court of law and there was no indictment from any of the grand juries or anything like that. There was sufficient evidence for her to make this ruling. So whether you want to defend what, like his innocence or whatever you want to do, that's on you or on anybody. I'm not talking to anybody in here in specific, but anybody in specific, if you want to defend his freedom and his innocence as you wish, that's on you. But what we have is her statement where she said that he had something. They found that his behavior was egregious to the point where she decided to levy a suspension on it. In terms of the appeals process, with the new CBA, the NFL, after this ruling, both sides having the option to appeal the decision levied down. The NFL is doing so and has announced it earlier today. And in terms of this, Roger Goodell will go down and he either him or somebody that he designates will end up being the person to levy the final suspension. And all accounts that I'm hearing is whatever he lays down after this is law. period. It doesn't matter, like, the six games. And if he wanted to up it to two seasons, he can do that. And it'll be final. So what's going to happen is if Roger Goodell comes down with a longer suspension and the Players Association decides to sue, we could have this go get tied up into the courts again. And this one won't be the people versus – this won't be those women versus Deshaun Watson. This will be the Players Union versus Roger Goodell the exact same way that it was in when Zeke took this to federal court and the Cowboys took it to federal court for that. So we could have a situation where his suspension gets delayed while this is being settled in actual court. And if that happens, then there's a very real possibility that he does end up on the field week one. And we can see eventually, like, he could end up playing all season. It just depends on how long this process is going to go out. Now, I've seen that the Players Association and the NFL are in talks about a settlement again, because they were in talks before the judge even released her initial levy. But they're, as of right now, they're in settlement talks. If they don't settle, I've seen that, for all intents and purposes, I've heard the NFL wants an indefinite suspension of at least a year. I've also heard the bare minimum they were willing to go to was 12 games. And I don't know where Goodell is going to land, but whatever he does, I have no reason to see why the NFLPA wouldn't kind of like go after that. But also, that's what they collectively bargained. So to me, they won't have any case. So I don't know why they would go to the courts. I didn't think they had a case when Zeke got suspended, but the NFLPA has never won a case in terms of going to court and taking the NFL to court over player conduct policy. They've never won. So it's going to be a wasted effort, in my opinion. So if they take this to court, this is just going to delay Deshaun Watson's suspension, in my opinion. And again, like I said, he might end up playing. We don't know. But if this goes to court, good chance we see him on the field in 2022.
Also, though, this is the first time that they ever delegated the initial suspension to a third party, right?
Like, yes, this is the first time this has ever happened.
Yeah, that was a part of, like, not the collective bargaining, but that's what the NFLPA in this situation had agreed upon, right? But I think this
that was a part of the CBA. That's the new CBA.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So this was collective bargaining. I think,
like, at least from an NFLPA standpoint, not that I'm rooting for Deshaun or anything like that, but from a CBA standpoint, or from the NFLPA standpoint, I should say, like, there is a definite bigger chance of that happening now. It's like, you guys agreed upon this. This is what happened. Here's what this judge, under your structure that you gave her, found to be right and fair. So, like, that's kind of the way I see it, is I don't know how you're going to go to another court and then have another judge turn around and say that this judge was wrong and that, you know, Goodell gets to be judge, jury, and executioner. Again, not that I'm saying that... And I don't know any details about any of this. It's all hearsay until all of this comes out. And if it comes out that he is an awful, awful human being, I will bury them right along everybody else. And if it's kind of shady, then I'll still bury him. Because I don't believe in none of that looks good. It's not going to be the case. But there is a rest of the team to talk about. We could talk about, you know, the potential of a Jimmy G trade happening now. If it is a agreed upon indefinite suspension, I would almost say you could almost put it, you know, take it to the bank that that's going to be a realistic situation. You were just talking about it a week ago, Nick, didn't you? Come on now.
No, I was mentioning it as a possibility, yeah. But I'm still a pro Jacoby guy.
Oh, you can be Jacoby guy, but Jacoby ain't winning playoff games. He damn sure ain't beating Aaron Rodgers in the playoffs multiple times. Like, that's just the case, the fact of the matter. So I think you have to look at the rest of this roster. Offensive line good. Wide receiving room's okay. It's not the worst. It's not the best. They got Cooper. Been injured. Been healthy. Had a decent year last year. The defense is solid. They got some of the, you know, Myles Garrett, some of the best players. I'll go to you, Nick. You know, kind of what do you think about the rest of the roster with or without Deshaun Watson? Say it is Jacoby Brissett for the entire season. where do you see this game, this team going? Because I don't think Jacoby is going to be an even plus 500 or even 500 QB.
No, but I wouldn't say he's that bad. I mean, he's dependable. But I guess I can see what you're saying. But with Cleveland, there's still a lot to like about this team. They're built pretty well. Like you said, the O-line's good. The running backs, you know, solid. This defense is pretty dang good. I think Cleveland's defense could potentially be a top 10 in fantasy. If I don't know if you guys, anyone still drafts defenses, I do. But
so you play defenses in fantasy,
bro? Yes, I play kickers too. I play kickers as well. But I, yeah, come on.
They're still in our leagues, and they'll still be in the BLITZ Fantasy League this year too. We ain't doing no QB shit anymore, though. Sorry, thank David. You're not taking control of this fucking shit no more. We're not doing no 2QB. It's going to be on ESPN. I'm going back to the basics, boys.
IDP.
There you go. I'm not against that. I'm not against that.
There's still my point is there's still a lot to like about Cleveland. Do I think they're going to be a absolute awful team? No, I think the worst or worst, this is a below, like around the 500 mark with if it's Brissett the whole year, but I'm not going to lay predictions out because it's just too hard to predict knowing the whole Watson stuff, but there's a lot to like. And Stefanski is the best coach this franchise has had since they came back. So I still believe that I haven't lost trust in him, but we'll see how this team does. There's a lot to like. I still trust Stefanski as the coach. I'm not going to throw out big predictions, like bold predictions about Cleveland, because it's just an unknown. There's a question mark surrounding this team. If Watson plays the whole year, absolutely this team's a playoff team. Could he be rusty? I don't know. But yeah, I'm not gonna throw anything in. There's just a lot to like. You guys can speak more about it.
Dominic, do you think that if Jimmy G's under the helm for 16 games, that's a complete side note, but do you think they're a playoff contender?
Hey.
With Jimmy G or yeah, without
with,
him?
With Jimmy G. We know what happens with Deshaun Watson. This becomes a three-headed monster, right? Like, mm-hmm. of a division. All three teams are probably making the playoffs. Like, if Deshaun Watson's there, you don't think Ravens and Cincy all three make the playoffs, Chaz?
I'm gonna let Dom go, and then I'm gonna let Nate go, and then I'll go last.
Okay. All right. Give me dirty looks over there. I mean,
you see my looks?
If it's Deshaun Watson, yeah. If it's Deshaun Watson at the helm, I think there's three teams coming out of the North. Well, I mean, the West. Never mind. All right, that is a rough one.
Yeah.
Two and two.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. You're right. All right. You can give me that dirty look. I got you. All right, sorry, Dom. Dirty look. Sorry, Dom.
It was just all good. I mean, if they do pull a trigger on a Jimmy G trade, that equation changes for sure. Because I think they're solidified as a playoff contender with him over Brissett. If Deshaun Watson doesn't play any portion of this game or this season, then they're looking at like a third place finish in the division. Possibly even fourth place, depending on injuries and how that receiving core pans out, you know? Yeah. Like we've said in other teams, that question mark is that quarterback, so.
Nate?
I'm gonna go out on the limb. I'm gonna be the guy going out on the limb. I'm gonna put out two hot takes with Cleveland right now. They're both gonna be statements. They're both probably not gonna be true.
Would you bet a hot chip over it?
No.
You take the words right out of my mouth.
No. One. They're not making the playoffs with Jacoby Brissett. You got to take off your fantasy. 100%. This isn't the statement, by the way. You got to take off your fantasy rose-colored glasses there.
I'm not wearing glasses, pal.
Look at it objectively. They're not going anywhere with Jacoby Brissett at quarterback. Statement one, Deshaun Watson, he'd been out of ball for a year. Like, I don't know that he comes back and is like automatically top five quarterback coming back in the league after taking a year off. Like,
fair, I'll give you that.
Coming into Cleveland, learning, he's going to have to learn a whole new thing. He's going to have this thing's going to hang over him regardless. I don't know that they're a playoff team with him. Now, also, they're not going to trade for Jimmy G unless Deshaun is suspended for the whole year. If it's 6 games or 12, they're not going to trade for another quarterback if he's going to play any of this year. If he's out and they trade for Jimmy G, I think they have a better chance at the playoffs with Jimmy G than they do with Deshaun this year.
Ooh, now that is spicy.
Spicy.
That's my spicy take.
I ain't even mad at it.
I'm not mad at it either.
I don't think that's spicy. I think it's a solid take.
I'm not mad at it.
If you put the two universes side by side and you said this universe, Deshaun Watson plays all 17 games. This universe, they trade for Jimmy G. Jimmy G starts all 17 games. I think that Jimmy G team is the better team than Deshaun's this year.
Dude, you know what? I think you're pretty much on point on that one. But I will go back to what you said earlier. So what if it is a 12-game suspension? Wouldn't you want Jimmy G to have you in play to get to the playoffs? Because Jacoby ain't going to do that. So you're basically chalking it up as a loss, like, regardless. Like, you're just cashing that. You're cashing that season in. If Jacoby Brissett and Josh Rosen are your two quarterbacks this year.
Josh Rosen's not making the team. I'm sorry.
Probably not, but. I think it's worth it.
I'd rather have Dobbs over Rosen. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry, that was major disrespect to the rocket scientist that is.
But it's still.
But
exactly, it's both irrelevant.
Yeah. I don't know. I think if it's even close, and again, we've never been in this situation. What's a 16 games or what's a season long suspension? Does that include playoffs? Is it just a 16 game or 17 game suspension? So then. Deshaun Watson could possibly come back for the playoffs. And then they did say that, I don't know if I read this right, but they said the suspension, Deshaun Watson, if the suspension will allow Deshaun Watson to still be in the building, right?
As of right now with the 6-game suspension, yes. He's still allowed. Well, he's still allowed to take part in training camp, but once we're going into week one and the preseason is over, then he can't. No, from 1 to 3. He can join the team after halfway through his suspension for weeks 4 through whenever. I don't know when their bye week is, but until they're – he can participate in, like, practices and team activities, but he can't play.
Here's my thing. There is no way, there is literally no way that if you – in that world where it's a year suspension, but he can come back for the playoffs, that they trade for Jimmy G – or get whoever else a quarterback to get into the playoffs to then say, all right, you're benched, Deshaun, you're in. There is no way that's happening.
But Jimmy would take that, though. That's the best option for Jimmy G right now because he's not going to Seattle.
He's not going to take
it. The Browns bye week is week 9, by the way.
There's no way he's taking that and being like, yeah, I'll go there to sit behind Deshaun. Like
after? I mean, yeah, I'd be pissed, too, if you took the whole team all the way there and then you get replaced. But, like, still, I think Jimmy wants to showcase. If Jimmy G sits around for a year, then his stock just plummets.
I got a feeling San Francisco would be like, hey, Deshaun's not suspended for the year. Jimmy G, you want us to trade you there? He's only suspended for 12. You're probably going to get pulled. I'm sure they're going to work with Jimmy G and be like, you know, do right by him. Yeah. Also, I don't see them saying we're going to ship you anyway. And you're going to be put in this other situation.
Again, there's one team that he's not going to. Or there's three other teams not going to. He's not going to the NFC West. I think outside of that, I think they literally would trade him to a potential contender in the NFC.
I would add New England on there because, you know, I'm not so sure New England would want him.
Okay, yeah, the Bucs.
From the San Francisco 49ers perspective.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I know. Fair
there's
point.
There's a lot, yeah. Obviously, the Bills aren't going to trade for him either. You know, there's a lot of teams that don't need a quarterback right now. But anyways, we can talk about the cluster, you know what's for a minute.
I haven't gotten my take off on the Browns' actual football team.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, I do tend to lean towards Nate's side. In terms of like what Nick said about their like Stefanski being their best coach, yes, but also he's not selling it for me, right? I don't think he's a lock to be somebody that takes this team and does right by them 100%, mostly because the man didn't bench Baker when he was hurt.
Fair clearly, point. I'll give you that.
All last year. And then add on, he takes the ball out of Nick Chubb's hands way too often for my liking. And he's far from a like Harbaugh or a Tomlin or somebody that I'm like, yeah, I know this dude is a good coach. I can trust in him. And I feel the same way about Zach Taylor. We'll get to that when we get to Cincinnati, but he's not somebody that I'm like, he's the right guy. And I know this. I'm not sold on Stefanski yet. That's number one. Number two, they got the best offensive line in the league. I don't think really that's a hot take, debatable, anything like that.
I'd probably go Baltimore number one.
give me Baltimore if you get to include the depth. Because yeah, if you go back, they have Falele is a backup tackle. Juwan James is a backup tackle. Ben Cleveland's a backup guard for Baltimore. Give me the depth all day on Baltimore over. But a starting five, yeah, I think Cleveland.
Starting five.
So yeah. I get no. Kansas City get no love for that O line. Okay.
Shit.
Kansas City got a great O line. I hate. But you see what the Browns is working with. Let's relax. Anyway, they got that. They got Nick Chubb behind it. They can still do damage, even if, you know, Jacoby Brissett is the starter for all 17. But I don't know how much damage they can do with Brissett is a major limiting factor. I think their ceiling, if Jacoby Brissett plays all 17, is 7 wins. Their ceiling. And I think you can if we say this with the – we think the Bengals and the Ravens are both the cream of the division, and they're going to be playing for the title in week 18 – or set, week 18. If they're going to be playing for the division, why would, like, where do we think they're going to end up at? If we think they're ending up at 11 wins apiece going into that game, that's being generous. I haven't looked through their schedules and did a game by game prediction. But if the floor, if we're talking about Jacoby Brissett's going to be a fringe playoff team at like 9 wins, how many wins is Deshaun Watson worth? So if Deshaun Watson plays at that point, they're winning the division. So I don't think Jacoby Brissett is anywhere near a playoff makes this team anywhere near a playoff contender, to be honest. And this defense does have holes. I like their star players. Denzel Ward is a top 5 corner in the league. Myles Garrett is arguably the best edge rusher in the league. After that, and Owusu-Koramoah was great as a rookie. So it was Newsom. After that, there's a lot of left to be decided, especially on their interior defensive line and including their linebackers. After Owusu-Koramoah, nobody on there, like the Sione Takitaki, bro. Like,
why did they ever their linebackers? What's his name?
Who?
Didn't they trade away a linebacker like this last year?
Collins?
Collins. Didn't they have him from? Yeah. Adam from back, New England, yeah. But then
no, not Jamie Collins. They drafted somebody they ended up trading away.
Yeah, Mac Wilson, I think you're talking about. He was traded to New England for Chase Winholm, I think his name is. Yeah.
Chase Winovich.
Who I do like.
I like Chase Winovich too.
But not against him.
Either way, like
sitting third. He's sitting John third Johnson's on their depth solid chart right now, but.
But their secondary, like I think Ward and Newsom is a great combo. Greedy Williams and Grant Delpit, both of them coming out of LSU going into the season, everybody was like, oh, this is going to be one of the best corner prospects. Grant Delpit is one of the best safety prospects. They haven't shown it in the league.
No.
They just haven't. And I think people are just sticking off of that name value from when they were prospects and saying that the Cleveland has a great secondary. Nah, it's really just Ward and Newsom. John Johnson is a capable safety.
Yeah, I like
that. But after, Yeah, I like John Johnson as well. I think that was one of the better free agent signings of last year. But that's besides the point. Their secondary, they have holes there. They have holes in the secondary. They have holes in the linebacker spot. They have holes in the defensive tackle spot. This defense isn't impenetrable. And if you want to talk about they can play defense and run the ball, the Ravens can do that better than they can. They can. And they have Lamar Jackson.
They can. Chubb is, I think, the second best back, top five for sure. I think I put him number two in the league right now. But, yeah.
But I'm with that when you don't use him.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what Chad said earlier. Like, you're 100% right. If you're not feeding him the ball, like, I looked at, like, again, doing mock drafts last night for the first time in fantasy, I'm like, wait, what were Nick Chubb's stats last year? Like, I know he got hurt, and I know him and Kareem had got hurt. You know, and they had freaking D'Ernest Johnson in, who still was running the ball damn good. So, I mean, anybody can run the ball behind that offensive line. And literally, if they would have just taken the ball out of Baker's hands and just force-fed the run game. Like, if they played some Niner-type ball, they would have won a handful of those games.
And that's really what it is. It's just it comes down to coaching. And, again, that defense has holes to me. I think – honestly, I could argue they have the worst defense in the division. Honestly, like, and we'll get to Pittsburgh next, but it's very top heavy. They got those names at the top, and then it bottoms out. It bottoms out quick. They got a lot of holes there that people aren't like looking at. But you got Myles Garrett, you got Owusu-Koramoah, you got Denzel Ward, you got Greg Newsome, and they cover up a lot of those holes. But you still got holes. So we'll see. But this defense and that run game, it can take you far. It's not going to take you that far. They need Deshaun Watson. Mm-hmm. Let's be real here. They need, like, that's why they traded three first-round picks for him. Like, they need somebody that can take them over the top. Like, Baker Mayfield, they didn't even make the playoffs with him last year. I get that he was hurt. But what we think that Jacoby Brissett at 100% is even Baker Mayfield at 70? Let's not. He's not. Be real here.
I mean, what did he do the last time he had a starting caliber role or a starting role? I mean, when Andrew Luck retired, he didn't do anything, and he had the best offense. Yeah, and he had the best offensive line in the league that year.
Didn't he start with Miami?
Yeah.
Yeah, he got.
And he didn't do nothing there either.
Mm-hmm. He got thrust into that kind of though more so, right?
And I ain't even trying to make this a Jacoby Brissett slander, hour, but like that's just we're just being real with where he is and with his evaluation. It's just like he's going to limit that offense. It's just that simple.
You know what's crazy with Brissett? He's like replaced a lot of top names. When Brady got suspended, he was the guy that when Jimmy G was there, he was part of that. When Luck suddenly retired after the Colts ruined him. He stepped up to the plate when I'm trying to remember Tannehill. The list, but Tannehill. Tannehill? No, I don't think it was Tannehill.
Well, it was a year after Tannehill, right? Yeah, it was a year after Tannehill, and then it was Fitzpatrick, I think.
Yes. But right? He's been very.
I don't know.
He's been the guy that's always been there.
No,
for
I'm
like,
sorry.
Yeah, you're off.
Way off on that. Yep, that's way, way backwards.
But point is, he's been there to replace the top guys who are out either via suspension or injury.
And these are the reasons that you saw sufficient enough to draft him?
No, I saw the opportunity. I didn't draft him, number one. I traded for him. Number two.
Would you have to trade for him?
Yeah. Oh, I got extra picks involved. He was just a throw-in for a pick swap, which I got a higher pick in. But, hey, listen, my backup was Jordan Love, and we all know he ain't starting for another few years, or probably never.
The quarterback room is horrendous.
Not true. Oh my God, not true. Buddy. I have Joe Burrow.
Putting a little too much. You're putting a little too much into your scouting abilities when it comes to fantasy. Trust me, I do the same thing because I'm always the team that's got the most rookie running backs.
This is my first year in Dynasty. All right, I'm learning. But
all right, we got to move on. 30 minutes of Cleveland Browns talk is 30 minutes too much.
I know where this is going.
The Pittsburgh Steelers, led by Mitchell Trubisky, Tiny Hands Kenny Pickett, a good run game. An okay wide receiving core, a decent wide receiving core, a young wide receiving core. Let's at least call it that. They're all on rookie contracts. I think all of them are. And then you look at that defense, and it's kind of a whole nother ball game. You look at the coaching staff, whole nother ball game. So, Chaz, I'm going to jump on over to you first. What do you think about this defense, this coaching staff? How much do you think that they are going to play a factor in the overall success of this team?
So, they dropped a hot take on the Cleveland Browns. I guess it's my turn. I don't even think this is a hot take. I think the Pittsburgh defensive line is the best defensive line in the NFL. And I wouldn't be surprised if they led the league in sacks again, because that's what they do. And then add on that you got Flores there as the linebacker's coach. Their linebacker room, hopefully he can make something out of Bush and Miles Jack. Obviously, they both have talent, but
so fast.
He gets something out of there. I think somebody I'm looking forward to having a huge year is Highsmith. I think he can break out this year and become like a solid number two pass rusher. I think he can hit double digits. I liked a lot of what I saw last year from him. Really, their weak point on their defense is their cornerback room. I think their cornerback one is who? Kelo Witherspoon, I think. And Trey Norwood played well last year for rookie. Obviously, you got Cam Sutton, who was solid. Minka is going to, like, carry that secondary. Terrell Edmonds finally grew into his own and so had a decent season. I don't know, check your head at. Terrell Edmonds played well last year.
He's a scrub.
You can call him whatever you want.
I think he's terrible.
Well, you'd be thinking wrong because you haven't watched him last year because he had a good season last year.
The only thing the guy does great is tackle players. He's terrible in coverage. I've seen this guy. Continue. I don't want to interrupt. But Terrell Edmonds is terrible.
But I will say this.
I'd rather have Kazee.
If you watched, hold up. If you watched Terrell Edmonds last year and you came away that he's a scrub, you need to evaluate your own scouting policies and look, and you need to reevaluate how you look at talent, because he had a good year last year. What you're talking about is because he was a reach in his draft class.
No.
And he has had, yes, because people have looked at him super raw. Yeah, he was super raw coming out of Virginia Tech, and he came out.
He was super raw. I'm just saying, no, that's not why I think that. I just don't think he's that great. Great.
People associate his name with that draft reach, and because he had a really slow start to his NFL career, last year he played very well. I'm not even gonna go back and forth with you no more about that. If you want to, you can go watch the tape again. But he had a really good season last year. But I digress. Anyway, Minka and Terrell Edmonds are probably the two best players in this secondary right now. Them two and Trey Norwood. And then, like I said, their defensive line depth, like TJ Watt, Cam Hayward speak for themselves. Alu-Alu is solid. They got Isaiah Loudermilk, and they got Chris Wormsley. They just drafted DeMarvin Leal. They just signed Larry Ogunjobi. They're deep. They're talented. They can rotate. Like, they play multiple. They can do whatever. They have one of my favorite fronts in the league, if not my favorite front in the league.
Best front seven in the game right now, I think so.
Yeah, I think that Flores addition, man, it's going to be – if he can get Miles Jack and Devin Bush to play to 80% of what their potential was coming out, that defense is going to be scary. It's the only question mark is boundary cornerbacks. If you got to play like Trey Norwood in the nickel again and have him down there and if Levi Wallace is getting like significant snaps on this defense, that's an issue, because he was the only weakness on Buffalo's defense last year. And he was like the reason they replaced him. and now he's the starter in Pittsburgh. It's just he leaves a lot to be desired, but this defense is going to be one of the top units in the league. And because of that, that's why I say Cleveland has the worst defense in the league or in the division, because yeah. Baltimore's defense is locked down. Pittsburgh has this defensive line. It's just we got to see it from those corners. And on offense, their biggest hole is the offensive line. I cannot watch another season of Kendrick Green. Luckily, he's not getting snaps at center anymore. He even said at a quote at training camp, he said, like, I did not enjoy playing center last year. I play guard. I'm a better guard than a center, which is true because you can't snap. And you were getting put on your ass every he couldn't hold a pocket. His anchor was terrible. It wasn't fun. Yeah,
he was Cameron Irvin level of bad when Irvin was sad.
They signed James Daniels, they signed Mason Cole, but they got some talent on the interior, but their tackles scare me, man. Okorafor is a swing tackle. He should be your sixth offensive lineman.
Yeah.
I don't think him being your like starting right tackle, I think you need to upgrade that. Dan Moore was solid last year. Do I think he's going to be like he's an adequate left tackle? I think he would be a bottom 12 starting left tackle in the league. Their tackles are a big concern for me. But outside of that, they got talent everywhere else, and obviously the question mark at quarterback. We'll see what Kenny Pickett does. We'll see who wins that battle with him and Trubisky. That offensive line scares me, particularly at the tackles. Also, Matt Canada scares me. I know that his offense a lot was limited by, like, Big Ben and him changing plays at the line, and Big Ben wanted to run what was most comfortable to him versus Matt Canada wanted to use more motion and wanted to use more pre-snap stuff, like deception on the defense, that he didn't really get to do last year. But we'll see what happens. I've never really been a huge fan of Matt Canada. But we'll see what happens with that offensive and the play calling there. Obviously, Najee Harris is Najee Harris. Deontay Johnson, we talked about him earlier in the pod. I like him a lot. Pickens was one of my favorite. He was in my top five wide receivers when we did that pod. So they got talent there. But their offense is going to live and die by the offensive line, and their defense is going to live and die by their secondary.
I'm sorry, Jack. You go.
No. I was just gonna transition in the next person. Feel free.
Oh, okay. Okay. I agree with a lot of what Chaz said. With the offensive line, I do have one guy I think that could help, and that's Tevin Jenkins, who it looks like he's on the outs in Chicago, and I could see Pittsburgh making a deal to acquire him and move him at tackle. I'm not saying it would be great and all, because I agreed with you before the podcast where I think he's more of a guard than tackle, but he's clearly better than what they have right now at left tackle. And, you know, he'd be worth a shot. I mean, he's coming off of, you know, a bad season last year where he had a back issue, and the games he played at tackle, I look back on him, he wasn't terrible for Chicago, but I'm just saying that as an option. I am very hyped with the Pittsburgh. This has been many years since I've been hyped with the Pittsburgh Steelers, and I know where this is going to go when I mention his name, but I am so sorry, Tomlin. I will forever apologize for saying that you were the reason, because now that the true guy that was the issue for many years, Big Ben, is gone, because he should have been gone years ago. And yes, he's talented. I get it. But he was the guy holding this team down for many years, and they should have gotten rid of him once he had that elbow injury. But the Steelers wanted him. You know, it's this trust thing, so I didn't blame him for that, but I still think this is going to be Pickett's job week one, because I've heard Trubisky is not doing well in training camp, even though I'm a big Trubisky guy. I did hear Rudolph is impressing, but I'm still Kenny Pickett guy. I wouldn't be surprised if he started. He's got weapons around him, which is great and all, and especially the running game. The investments they made interior on the offensive line, I liked a lot. Like, Mason Cole was probably the best signing Pittsburgh made this offseason, offense-wise, because like you said earlier, with what's his name, Kendrick Green. He was terrible at the center position. Cameron Irving, bad at when he played center for Cleveland. So that's great. The defense, I think this defense is very good. The D line, I'm gonna save a little bit for you guys, but secondary kind of concerns me. You know how much I'm not a Terrell Edmunds guy. He did have a better season, but the guy wasn't, you know, fantastic for Pittsburgh last year. But Witherspoon was the guy that truly impressed me out of that secondary. He was pretty good. And with both Tomlin and Flores as coaching duo, oh God, that sends chills to my spine knowing that both of them are on the same coaching staff. I'm hyped for Pittsburgh. It wouldn't shock me if they, you know, are the third or second best team. I don't think that's probably an overstatement. That's probably their ceiling, but I could potentially see that. Would it shock me if the team's at like at a wild card spot or like barely missing the playoffs with like 9 or 8 games? No, it wouldn't shock me. But yeah, there's a lot to be excited about in Pittsburgh. I like where this organization's going, and I'm going to leave meat on the bone for you guys. So you guys can speak next, either Nate or Dom.
Gentlemen.
Hey. Oh, well, I mean, I don't really have a whole lot to add to what you guys have said. Let's not forget that Pittsburgh did make the playoffs last year.
Oh, like, I forgot. Yeah, my mistake on that. My bad.
So I think they got better. I think they're going to have, you know, what, regardless of what you think of Trubisky or Pickett, I think their quarterback play could be better. Big Ben has, you know, he was in command of the offense, but he just didn't have the arm anymore. I mean, you could see he was just floating the balls out there and everything like that. So I think they could be in a better spot there. I mean, I can't believe nobody mentioned Mason Rudolph in the conversation for the job there.
Nick brought him up.
But
Nick brought him up.
I missed it. Yeah. I missed it. Sorry.
It's all right. You're forgiven, Nate.
But it did say the last thing I heard was is basically Trubisky's job to lose, though. And I don't think a bad couple days at camp or anything are gonna you know, jeopardize that once we get in the preseason games and he starts, you know, being able to, you know, kind of actually be in the flow in the offense and not just practice and training camp stuff. I don't think, I mean, people throw picks in training camp. I think 2 years ago before the Super Bowl year, I think Patrick Mahomes threw like all kinds of picks in training camp. I'm not saying any of these guys in Pittsburgh are going to be that level, but like, I don't think that's a big indication of things. You're trying to figure out what you can do in that offense. This is when you do throw the picks. This is when you do throw the incompletions and stuff like that, is when you're getting a feel for what you can get away with and develop the chemistry and all that kind of stuff. So I don't think that's a real big indication of that. They have weapons, they have pieces. If Najee and Freiermuth can advance and grow in what they, you know, build upon what they did last year, I think there's a really good weapons there. You got Deontay there. You got Pickens, who could be a massive target and a huge upgrade for them at the wide receiver position. And then that defense is solid. I'm with you on that one, Chaz, on that. So that's kind of all I got with them. I think they can be in the mix for a playoff spot for sure. I'm not counting them out.
Yeah, like you guys were saying, I mean, I love their defense. I think their front seven's going to hide a lot of that deficiency in the corners.
Yep.
A lot. And it's going to basically have their corners need to be serviceable. And how much of a disruption will that front seven be to make those corners look even better? You know, that offensive line is going to be where their season is made or is broken, because they're going to need to be a lot better than what they look on paper. You know, whether that's incorporating zone blocking or whatever the case may be, that they're going to need to play out of their league, so to speak.
Fun fact, Steelers actually ran the second most amount of zone blocking in the division. When Bengals, then the Steelers, then the Ravens, then the Browns. I looked that up after Tyler Linderbaum got drafted to the Ravens, and I wanted to double check there how often they ran power versus zone. Uh-huh. And I was actually pretty surprised that the Steelers actually ran more zone than power last year.
Yeah, especially you think with Najee. But I don't know. There's no zone blocking when it comes to a five or a seven step drop or playing shotgun. And when it comes to that in preseason, or not even preseason, and in training camp against those top two, or not even against those top two, but against their edge rushers that they have, like, how are they not getting exposed in camp right now? Like, how are they not worried? Like, holy shit. Like, I know we have a good front seven, and our offensive line is getting, they're probably, that offensive line has to be getting completely torched. And there still is quite a few guys on free agency, and the Steelers do have quite a few guys, or have quite a bit of cap space. They have just under $15 million, 14.3, I think it is. Dwayne Brown, Eric Fisher, Brandon Schell, Mike Rammers, Nate Soldier. Like, not saying, like, Ty Nesecki, not saying that those guys are world beaters, but they're veterans. They're seasoned vets that have starts under their belt. They could definitely add at least depth to this offensive line. But I think half of those names are still probably day one starting and having a better presence on that offensive line than who they have right now. Yep. And then again, the only other point I make that's been doubled down already is what Chaz and Dominic had said in terms of that front seven will mask everything, all the deficiencies in the secondary, not even in the secondary, just with those three corners that are going to be out there, four corners in dime. Like, all of that gets masked because they're going to have an extra, or there's going to be a less of a half second to a whole second less of coverage due to how fast those guys are going to get after the ball. I especially with Miles Jack back there at linebacker, how fast those two are going to be between him and Bush. Oh, you have to think that they're going to have to pull a little bit of that Todd Bowles too, and being able to blitz those guys. Like, it's going to be destructive. The fact that, like, these guys are being slept on, this defense being slept on as the top defense in the league is kind of funny to me. Because, I mean, you could say the Bills, you can say the Bucks, you can say the Niners, but, like, nobody's saying, like, the Pittsburgh Steelers. And they were in that mix the entire time last year. You know, with the Bucks before they got hurt, there was that debate back and forth between our group of which defense was better, the Bucks defense or Pittsburgh's. And, you know, once Bush got hurt, like, that kind of changed things, you know, quite a bit in terms of not having that center fielder to kind of hold down the fort. But we know it's the offensive line, it's the quarterback. Najee is going to do what Najee does, but if you don't open up run lanes for him, like, again, there was a lot of hate. We use this term too much and we have to get rid of it, but there was a lot of meat left on the bone in terms of what Najee could have had last year in terms of a rushing performance compared to what his offensive line gave him, because it was bad last year. And I know they added pieces, I know they added James Daniels, but I don't know if that offensive line is up to par. And I think if you have a subpar offensive line to start the season, it ain't going to get any better. Maybe they'll get, you know, some cohesion, but at the end of the day, like, that's going to be the downfall of this team. And I don't see them being especially because we just talked about with the AFC West, and we talked about if Deshaun Watson plays, there's no way that they even sniff the playoffs this year, I think.
I want to ask you a question, Jack. Pittsburgh, with you said the offensive line, you didn't mention Tevin Jenkins like I did earlier. Could you see Pittsburgh? Because Pittsburgh, they've been known to take on, you know, locker room cancers. They've been known to take chance on players who, you know, are on the outs, have injuries. They're willing to take that risk. Could you see Tevin Jenkins being acquired by Pittsburgh?
Yeah. You guys still hear me, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know. I just told me my audio cut out or something like that on here. Yeah, I definitely think that, like, there's so many teams that could use a Tevin Jenkins, and, like, I butchered his name earlier again. Long day. But I could see it. There's so many teams need young talent on the offensive line, especially you talk about a first to second round prospect is what most teams probably had a grade on him. And I mean, you could probably get him, what you said, a fourth round pick in your
I believe I said a fourth round pick.
And I think a fourth round pick is probably right around there. Like, anytime somebody takes a swing on somebody and then they're trying to trade them like a year later, 2 years later, it definitely drops. Like, you're not going to go get a first round pick or a second round pick for a player like right after you just, you know, obviously whiffed on him. But I don't know. You knew if you watched him play.
Chicago's ruining.
If you watched him play in college, you knew he had an attitude. That's all I gotta say. But we have.
It's a disaster.
Reigning, defending, AFC champions, the Cincinnati Bengals.
I'm shocked he didn't use a soundboard for that.
We have it.
There you are.
Good call, Nick. Good call. Chaz, the floor is yours.
I see Nate.
We'll jump down to Nate, and then we'll double back down to Dom, and then up to Nick. But yeah, like, this is your team. Floor is yours. Have it.
I'm gonna get my popcorn.
Tell us where it's at. Tell us where the weaknesses are, though, too. Don't lie to us.
Oh, yeah. Oh, for sure. Again, I in terms of, like, starters – I think their starters can like line up against most team starters in the league. My big issue with this team is depth. And it's like, honestly, everywhere. Like, even their wide receiver room, I think they got the best top three, sorry, Jack, and of any team in the league. And you got T. Higgins, Ja'Marr Chase, and Tyler Boyd. After those three, it gets super thin. Super quick. Like, they had Auden Tate beforehand, and, like, now he's in Atlanta. And then I think after that, I think you got, like, Mike Thomas, who's a special teams guy. Stanley Morgan, who's a special teams guy. Mike Thomas, not Michael Thomas, Mike Thomas. And then you got Trent Taylor. It's like, you got a bunch of, like, low-level pieces behind those threes. It's Cincinnati, as much as the Ravens were super snake-bitten with injuries last year, Cincinnati was very lucky. They didn't really get hurt. Even players that had had injury concerns in the past, like Joe Mixon had been banged up a lot of the times in the past. Jonah Williams as well. Like, we've had a bunch of players come through there and have injury concerns, and none of those manifested last year. That's why they were able to make that run. Their defensive line, I think, really is probably their deepest unit and best unit, obviously outside of the starting receivers. But Hubbard, Reader, Hill, Hendrickson, Cam Sample was a good player last year and contributor. Josh Tupau, or however you pronounce his name. I'm not entirely sure on that one, even though I'm usually the one that's doing the corrections here. But he's somebody they drafted Zachary Carter in the third round. Joseph Osai is my big one. I think him coming back is going to be somebody that can have a second pass rusher aside from Hendrickson, who pretty much did all of the pass rush work last year. So they finally have somebody else that can be opposite him and they can have a second rusher. Their linebacker core is pretty deep, but again, it's no like real like star players. It's just, it really, their defense really relied on coaching a lot. Lou Anarumo played a really vital role in like their second half adjustments, especially, and being able to make those like shifts on the fly to hold Mahomes to 0 points in the second half in those games until like, you know, the last field goals. But like, when they beat the Chiefs twice, they were locking down. It was the defense making plays because of the adjustments and because of the coaching staff. Really, I have like more faith in the defensive coaching than I do in the offensive coaching. It's kind of that where I said I'm not really sold on Stefanski. I kind of hinted at it earlier where I said I'm not entirely sold on Zach Taylor. Like, it's more so of a, was it the players or was it the coaching? Because a lot of like people who followed the Bengals closely can tell you last year, the play calling wasn't consistent. You had games where they were too committed to the run, like in Denver, where they won 15-13, because of one long pass they made to Tyler Boyd on a leak play, where it's like, was that play calling and conservativeness in play calling because of the injury, or Joe Burrow coming off of the injury, or was it because that's what they want to do? And we got to see it. Like, and it's hard to even say that because they just went to the Super Bowl. But, like, I still got to see if their dedication to the run and their kind of, like, conservativeness on offense, quote unquote, is a theme, or was that because Joe Burrow was coming off that injury last year? So that's kind of what – and it's weird because even then, Joe Burrow led the league in yards per attempt and air yards per attempt last year, but their offense was really conservative. They relied a lot on those big plays with Jamar and T down the field. But again, I need to see more consistency in the play calling, because that's really going to be that weakness. Obviously, they upgraded the offensive line with their with the free agency, but that's not everything. They still have depth issues along everywhere on offense, and I got to see the coaching improve to give me a sense of security that this wasn't a one-year, like, wonder with just Burrow and Chase making plays and saving the offense pretty much.
All right, real quick. And beating Mahomes twice. Real quick. Does everyone else agree with that, what Chaz said, in terms of wide receiving corps? You technically said top three.
That's top three.
Top three. So you'll say that the Bucs have the better receiving corps, but you have the better top three?
Oh, yeah. Oh yeah, for sure. I've maintained this. The Bucs are deeper than the Bengals, for sure. Like, if you take in all, like, the entire room, they're deeper than the Bengals. But if you're talking about, do I want to start Jamar T and Tyler Boyd, or Evans, Godwin, and who's the third?
Gage
or Julio.
Quote from Jack,
I don't want Julio playing more than 30% of the snaps and all this kind of stuff. Yeah, but no, now he's going to advocate for Julio being the number three. Okay.
I did not advocate. I said, we'll see. I don't know. I said, we don't know.
Yeah, but
that's what I said. I mean, if you've been watching any of the highlight reels in training camp, they're definitely showcasing how much that Tom Brady loves Julio Jones. I know. But again, Julio's guy, or Tom Brady's guy. But Tom Brady called them both. Tom Brady called Russell and brought him in. Tom Brady called Julio and brought him in. So who knows who he's going to love more. I will say, I think, obviously, career-wise, Mike Evans is like, gets so disrespected and slept on.
I am not going to disrespect Mike Evans.
He's not the sexiest receiver ever, and will never, ever be considered the number one receiver. No matter what, he'll never be the number one receiver in the NFL, no matter what. And yet he might go down as, like, from a career-wise, the best wide receiver his entire generation, but yet will not be the number one receiver. And I will even have to admit that. Sorry, Mike. Love you, buddy. But give me Chase. But after that, I don't know. Definitely either one of those, like, Godwin wins, injury or not. Like, Godwin is the clear-cut second best. No? You would rather have T. Higgins.
I love you some T. Higgins.
You would rather have Tyler Boyd.
I would rather have T. Higgins.
T. Higgins is a poor man's Mike Evans. Chris Godwin's one of the best route runners in the game. Chris Godwin is one of the best all-around receivers in the game.
If you want to compare that, Tyler Boyd is a better route runner.
I don't know about that one.
Tyler Boyd, if you want to talk route running now, Tyler Boyd, I think Chris Godwin, when it comes down to it.
No. I said this last year. I think Chris Godwin's the best receiver on the Bucs.
No, he's not.
I
think in terms of all around talent, I think he is. I think he was, and he got hurt, and it didn't get to be showcased.
Either way you're looking at it, you're looking at T. Higgins or Tyler Boyd with Russell Gage. As far as who you're evaluating against.
We definitely got the number two locked in. Because ain't nobody, I don't give a shit what you guys say. You're never going to convince me otherwise. Chris Godwin is better than both of them.
No. I love me some T. Higgins. I don't know.
I know, dude, I love me some T. Higgins. Don't put me in that situation.
I think it's close. I think it's close. No cap. I think it's close because T. Higgins, he missed the game last year.
Hop chick challenge right now. Any takers? Career, Chris Godwin over T. Higgins.
How are we going to measure that, though? That's going to be like a
I'll come back five years and 10 years from now, and I'll be like,
he might not even make hot chips anymore.
Yeah, there might not even be a Blitzlytics by then. We may have all gone our separate ways.
Oh, don't say that. Jack, don't say that. We'll be here forever. Maybe. I don't know.
That was never the goal of Blitz.
I'm intrigued because T. Higgins has Joe Burrow for the foreseeable future. And
yeah, I know Chris Godwin.
Tom Brady already retired once.
Yeah, but that was just to go play for Miami. So,
we'll come back to this chip bet.
Oh yeah, yeah. After Brady retires, you're gonna be like, I'll take that chip bet right now.
No.
I'm not taking it. I'm not taking that.
All right, let me get my feelings on my Bucks BS and me and Chaz's never-ending banter aside, we'll get back to finishing this podcast.
Yeah, well, let's get back into me and Chaz's banter on this. I saw this little slight that he had about beating Kansas City twice, holding Patrick Mahomes to no points in the second half. And it was Cincinnati's defense. I will say they are super underrated. They don't get love, but. It was more about what the Chiefs didn't do than what the Bengals did. All right. I can show you. They dropped eight back in coverage, and Patrick Mahomes still had spots where he could have had touchdowns or just run the ball for 6-7 yards a carry like you were doing and just hand it off and win the game.
Problem.
I'm just saying.
He went full read that game.
Anyway. So that's where we're at with that. Also, maybe don't have cover zero one-on-one with Jamar Chase out there. Give no help on there in press coverage. Maybe don't do that either. But that's besides.
Are you questioning your coaching staff now?
In those
sounds like you're a little bit more concerned than Chaz is.
I'm saying in those situations, absolutely.
Oh, the AFC Mahomes West spot is going to be fun.
Mahomes is going to be fine. You're going to see the next evolution of him, and he won't have those second half issues like he did this game. Anyway, Cincinnati, though, it's all music to Chaz's ears right now. You did this.
Who did? They did.
Chaz. Anyway. The depth is the concerning piece. I do think they upgraded their offensive line, so it's going to be fun to see, like, you know, what the offense can be without Joe Burrow taking 50, 60 sacks, however many he took, some ridiculous amount. So it'll be fun to see what they can do. The concern is, like Chaz said, the depth on that. If any of those pieces get hurt, if Mixon goes down or if one of those wideouts goes down or – you know, where do they go from there? Because that's they're very short on everything else after that, like looking at their roster and everything. I do think their defense was underrated, played really well down the stretch and in the playoffs. Like they were lights out in the playoffs. I'm a little concerned to see if maybe some of these guys maybe come back down to earth a little bit or you know, they balled out at the end of the year at the right time, got hot and played well. And they come back this year and be more of an average defense type of middle of the road type of defense. And that'd probably be enough with the way the offense goes. But it's really nitpicking at that point. I do think they're going to come back and win the division, but I think it's going to be a tight race between them and Baltimore.
Dom?
Yeah, I mean, like what Chaz and Nate both said, that depth is going to be the issue. I mean, after the season, the offensive line was the issue, but they upgraded that with bringing in Kappa and Collins especially. And even though this defense does have that depth issue, is this going to be a case where the offense can put up 40 points to a 30-point surrender for the defense, you know? That's going to be where the issue is, you know?
I feel like they fixed a lot of the flaws from last year, but it isn't to say that this team didn't go on a crazy run that lived up far past the talent level, like the overall talent level. I think they did. It was somewhat of a Cinderella story. Again, like, you, who's ever had that bad of an offensive line and still made the Super Bowl? Like, that is just so impressive. I mean, yeah, KC. But, like, that was before. Like, you didn't lose your two starting tackles until you got to the Super Bowl.
We lost one of them week five. The other one was AFC Championship game. But we also lost two guards before that.
You could probably throw Chicago when they went to that Super Bowl against Indianapolis. Their O-line wasn't great during that time, but that's many years ago.
Yeah, but their offense was never on the field because Hester returned everything.
Yeah.
That man's a Hall of Famer. I don't care what anybody says. Devin Hester should be in the Hall of Fame right now.
So should Mike Allstott. But yeah, that's a whole nother podcast. We can get into that after the Hall of Fame game this week.
To be continued.
But all right, let's wrap this up because this is pushing on a 2-hour podcast.
Okay.
Nicholas, what do you think is going to happen with Cincinnati Bengals? We've already talked about the players. We've already talked about the coaching staff. Just overall, how do you think they're going to pan out? Are they repeating this year? Are they going back to back in terms of, you know, AFC Championship, Super Bowl? Are they winning the division? What's your kind of feel for where they're at right now?
See, they're going to be it's tough for prediction wise because, again, we don't know what's going on with, you know, Cleveland and Deshaun. But as of now, I'm going to label them the favorites of winning this division. But Baltimore, if they stay healthy, is sneaking up. But yeah, I unless injuries occur with Cincinnati or they just fall apart, I don't see how they not make the playoffs. I think they're going to make the playoffs. Super Bowl, we'll see. You know, like, things could change. They're definitely contending for one. But yeah, we'll see. We'll see how Cincinnati goes. I think they're going to be good this year. We'll see about division, if they win the division, but I think Cincinnati is absolutely a playoff team.
100% agree. Let's just see how good they are. I think we're going to find out. We're going to find out if Burrow really is the Burrow that we thought he was, this Joe Montana-esque, like, legendary figure in the making. Zach Taylor going to be able to keep it rolling? Will he be kind of the downfall? Because, again, I 100% agree with what Chaz had said. There was games where they didn't run the ball, and then there was games where they were like, all right, well, now we're going to run the ball, and then they ran it to a fault and didn't even set each other up. Like, they don't play complementary football at all, and I think that's something that maybe Zach Taylor has to learn. But if you get this deep into it, you know, how long ago was it that we were watching or we interviewed him in Mobile? You know, it was like, what, 3 years ago, 4 years ago at this point now? So it's like, it's kind of put up or shut up. Obviously, you made it to the Super Bowl. You're doing something right. But I think that was so much more on the players than it was actually the coaching staff. Maybe I'm wrong, but we will. There's only one way to find out, and we're about less than 40 days away from finding out at least what happens in week one. So thank you all for tuning in. We appreciate it. Gentlemen, Nicholas, tell them where they can find you on Twitter.
Oh, well, of course. Yeah, so if you guys are living under a rock or haven't seen earlier this podcast, I joined the Bird app. I've flown over there and I've started a Twitter. You can find me at Nicholas Mullick, but keep in mind, that's not the number one social media out there. I'm always on LinkedIn. You can message me on there. You know, you can contact me, you know, if you want to see me as well. I write a lot up on BlitzLix. I try to break the system, break the codes, you know. But
a simple at Nicholas Mullick would have sufficed.
Oh, I'm sorry. But look, I'm new to this. I'm new, okay? You're not that new.
No, you're not. You're new to Twitter. You're not new to this game. Podcasting spectrum. He's also killing it all over BlitzLytics.com. He's producing like an article to two articles a day, just blowing everybody else out the water here at this company. So one of the hardest working people in the business right now, if not the Mr. Nicholas Muller. Please go follow him on Twitter and LinkedIn and on blitzlytics.com. Chaz, tell these people where they can find you.
Find me on Twitter at CCNFLDraft. And you can find me everywhere being a menace, as always. Love to see it. I'll be rooting for the Bengals, talking down on Patrick Mahomes and Mike Evans on all social media platforms in the year 2020.
What did Mike Evans ever do to you? Come on now. Mike Evans has done nothing to you.
I challenge you to put some Pat Mahomes slander out on Twitter and see what happens. You deserve it. Go ahead. Nobody talks bad about that man.
I say people talk bad about Patrick Mahomes all the time. I don't know where you see it on Twitter.
It's not validated.
And they get rightfully roasted for it.
Yeah.
There's sometimes they're proper in it, but we'll that's see. A different story.
I bet I could find you some tweets right now that got traction that slander Patrick Mahomes.
Mr. Nate, I didn't find you. After I butchered your last name that one time, I'm always so scared to say it. I am. I look at it every time.
It's okay. It's not hard. Sabelka.
Sabelka, I know. It's so easy, but I'm always I'm Mr. Nate instead of Mr. Sabelka.
I'm that's
like,
fine. I'm Mr. Nate. I'm at Nate Kansas on Twitter. Dom, how about you?
You can find me at Dom Ambrose 10 on Twitter.
You can find me at Jack Bourgeois, JackBoushwa. But more importantly, just go to that blitzlytics.com or go follow us at Blitzlytics on Twitter, on Insta, on whatever social media platform. But more importantly, just go hit that like and subscribe button. Keep those followers rolling in on YouTube for us. Help us monetize this channel. Make some money. Try to get in the green when it comes to all of our media content that is being produced by Blitzlytics. Big shout out to our sponsors, Key City Brewing. I know all of my font is backwards. It's just the way we record. I can't help it. So drink, roll, repeat. Shout out to Key City Brewing. Great beer. So Blitz out. Sick, tired of this Mike Evans disrespect. You gotta kill me.